Dear friends, thanks a lot. Welcoming back. Now we are having our second session on a highly important issue, reflecting upon multilateralism and regionalism. Before we start, I think we all have noticed that we just had a nice and dynamic discussion on the WTO negotiations under the moderation of Ricardo. And there are many things to be worth noting, of course, under that session. But just one thing, I think Ambassador Aaron, he has said something which catches my attention when he said that WTO is lost and then the fellow negotiators are not to blame. I fully agree with him, simply because that, like him, not long ago, I was also one of these fellow negotiators, so I don't want to take the blame. But we may not be so generous in a few years' time, once we find ourselves more distance in terms of timing from our former fellow negotiators. So I encourage those negotiators to do their job and then take wisdom, of course, from our discussions today. Because we are already running behind the schedule, so I won't take too much time to set the stage. Because you all know this is a topic we have been debating for long, more than 10 years. In the beginning, we have been talking more or less about the good aspects and the bad aspects of regionals, RTAs, and then we came to a conclusion that, in generally speaking, the RTAs are creating more trade. And now we are coming to the second stage about discussion on how do we enhance the complementarity and also coherence between the multilateral trading system and regional trade agreements. And we have put forward a few pressing questions. I think I look forward to a dynamic discussion today and trying to find answers to these questions. I won't do introduction to each and every panelist, because for the time's sake, because you could find the brief bios in the papers documents in front of you. So with all the further ado, I will just start immediate discussion. I will just want to change a little bit the order of the presentation. I will start with Uli from Bertelsmann, because he's going to present us a more kind of general picture about the RTAs, in particular the bigger regionals and its impact on the insiders and outsiders. And then we start from the order as originally planned, starting from Anthony afterwards and all the way towards on my right, Professor Kim. So Uli, you have the floor, please.
Thanks, Lou. Thanks a lot for inviting me. I think I've worked for the ILO for two or three years, and it's always good to come back to Geneva. It's such a somewhat strange as well. But let me maybe start with getting you smoothly into the topic, looking a little bit at the economic effects of mega-regional trade agreements. And I think because there are a lot of fears in the room, what does it mean, who is benefiting from it, who will lose, who will win. And that's why we have, since 3 years, we have done extensively a lot of work on and teamed up with the IFU Institute in Munich to calculate different RTAs, and particularly all mega regionals that are currently negotiated, and I will come to this later on. And first of all, I want to show you, fascinate you with this kind of nice view of Jagdisch Bagwadi's spaghetti bowl. And we talked a lot about communication. And we are dealing with a complex world, particularly when it comes to RTAs. And so visualization is one way to make it more vivid and to see what's going on. What you see here is a tool we have designed. It's an interactive tool. You can access it. It's called FTA Wiz. This is just a static screenshot of it. It's totally free, and it visualizes all trade agreements and RTAs worldwide from 1948 to 2014. And not only that, it is visualizing the RTAs and this kind of circle you see and spaghetti bowl, but also you can see also the depth of these trade agreements that are assessed in color. So for example, when it's getting warmer, yellow and red, you can see trade agreements are getting deeper and more comprehensive, including non-tariff trade barriers. And you, what you can see here nicely is, for example, that of course the warm areas are of course more found in Europe and to some extent North America, United States, and more the, let's say, the cold areas are here on the other side, Africa, because the whole thing is separated into the continents, and when connections are outside, it's connections outside within the continent, and of course the connections between the continents are inside. So that's a really nice visualization, and if you want to check it out, it's just freely available under ftawiz.com, and it shows also what I've this one you will see also there is just showing you once again what we are facing. It's not that we are getting more and more RTAs each year. The number of new RTAs is decreasing, but it's going to the RTAs are going to be more deep and more comprehensive, including regulations and non-tariff trade barriers in general, which leads us then finally to the mega regional initiatives that we want to talk about here. And I have mentioned these four ones: TTIP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, RCEP, and the FTAIP, although this is pretty much in question if we will see it. But these are the four we have also analyzed, and we have calculated different scenarios and impacts for 120 countries worldwide. And I cannot present you all the scenarios, so we'll have 10 minutes, so we'll make it quick. So what are really the economic effects, not only for the partner countries, but also for third-party countries? And key learnings, what we find when modeling economic effects of mega-regional is, first of all, surprisingly, so maybe to take away some fear of some people, that the negative economic welfare effects of mega-regional trade agreements, like particularly TTIP, TPP, or RCEP, not FTAIP is a special case, on third-party emerging markets seem to be rather low, and I will I'll tell you a little bit more about this later with an example of TTIP. Why is this? Because we see that negative trade diversion effects and positive income effects, so particularly as a consequence of increasing power, purchasing power within the partner countries that stimulate, again, demand, seem to outbalance each other quite well. This is the reason why we do not see such negative trade diversion effects and negative welfare effects as a consequence. And however, we are seeing, of course, differences and disparities between third-party countries, and some lose more than others. And in the first panel, we had the notion of convergence. This is, of course, divergence, what we here see. And even if you have negative welfare effects for some countries, which are pretty low, particularly if you regard it in a certain time period, they can, of course, have severe impact on welfare distribution inequality within some countries. Just for example, like Mozambique, as a producer of aluminium, but 80% of the people are working in agriculture. And if you have trade diversion effects in agriculture, but only the benefit that is compensating for this is coming from the aluminium demand, like, for example, from China or other countries, then, of course, you have severe problems, probably in a country where we are dealing with the poorest people already. So, and finally, of course, fostering spillover effects or regulatory spillover effects in mega-regionals like TTIP is crucial for making it more inclusive for all. And I will just make the case now for TTIP. And as you can see, and what I have already told you, negative effects on emerging economies seem to be relatively low from TTIP. What you see here is of course the world map and the negative effects. If we have a baseline scenario of a deep TTIP, also a comprehensive agreement scenario, not a shallow one with only just reducing tariffs, we see that there are some countries, particularly the one in orange, China, Mongolia, and in Africa you have Mozambique, Zambia, or Ivory Coast, or in Latin America like Chile like Chile, for example. And here you could have negative effects of such a TTIP agreement, but only, and this is what we mean with relatively low, maximum up to minus 1% of GDP growth. And this take is taking place in the realm of the next 10 or 15 years. So basically, if we look at the, let's say, biggest losers, it sounds really drastically, but it probably is not such a big case. You see that there's that this is not really crossing the minus 1% of GDP growth. And if you compare it, and what you see, this is what you see in the green bars, you know, the negative growth effects, and what you see in the blue bars is the current growth rate. So it puts this to some extent in relation to see that it's relatively low, although for some countries nevertheless it matters. And this is a very interesting picture, because this is what the EU Commission as a model applies, that it's rather could become a win-win situation. TTIP could become a win-win situation for all if you apply, or if you assume that spillover effects will happen. So regulatory spillover effects, meaning, well, one side and two in one way and two ways spillover effects, meaning on the one hand that countries or emerging markets can reduce trade costs because they have just one standard to deal with, or two ways that emerging markets are adapting to regulations and standards very quickly. But this is an assumption which is not really empirically proven scientifically, that automatically if you have that these kind of spillover effects are happening. So it's very difficult to use it in econometrical model and just to apply arbitrarily some kind of number for trade reduction cost. But I just wanted to show you that nevertheless the lesson here is, of course, that spillover effects matters, and that's why it's of course important to promote spillover processes and in those kind of mega regional deals. And here we are back a little bit back to the main topic of the conference today. And that's why, of course, it is important for mitigating preference erosion effect on third countries to avoid strict rules of origin in those countries, for non-tariff barriers, and particularly mutual recognition of standards should be extended to third economies as much as possible, which is clear also to make a TTIP more inclusive and to foster this kind of spillover effects. Here, an independent body for inspecting regulatory compliance could be an idea. And make regulatory cooperation processes as transparent as possible for third party countries. And here again, another idea came into my mind when I was listening to the inputs of the first panel. I think what we are witnessing, particularly in Germany, I'm from Germany, is with TTIP that there is a strong hostile attitude towards TTIP, and it's even getting worse. We have just did a couple of surveys 2 years ago and now, and the majority of people is against TTIP. It's a lot of protest. It's also the same thing in Austria. And one thing I have in mind, because the people are not against free trade, they even say they want to have more free trade with the United States. It's this kind of difficulty that things they deal, like regulations, that standards they deal with every day, are negotiated in the name of trade. And because with trade they associate different things, and that's why I think it's very important to look at regulatory cooperation processes, even best practices, also where they are taking place outside of trade agreements, maybe to advance here on different levels. And leave the door open, that was already mentioned, include clause for potential accession for other countries, or approach those countries very quickly, particularly neighboring countries like Mexico for the US or Turkey for the European Union, because Turkey has, of course, a massive problem with the customs unit, that they are facing disadvantages in trade when a TTIP will come into implementation. And in general, and that's what I try, of course, what we try to do, of all, provide more information on worldwide production and supply networks and country-level analysis of sectoral trade, a structure for better assessing trade patterns and potential diversion and spillovers. So really this kind of information transparency issue. If you want to see more, just some advertising at the end, we have just put all these kind of calculations into three publications on world trade regions. One is on Latin America, one mega regionals on Asia, which just came out, and the effects of mega regionals on Africa will come out next week. This is the one on the right-hand side. And if you want to know how your country is doing, actually, we have put the country results into 120 fact sheets that you can also download from the page. So you can always see how your country will be would be affected in different scenarios of these mega regional trade deals. That's it. Very quickly. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Uli. I think the methodology that Bertelsmann has been using in visualizing the impact of the mega regionals for those insiders and outsiders are really fantastic. I think that will bring a lot of new thoughts towards the discussion here in Geneva and beyond. But one thing I think which in your introduction which caught my attention was really about the kind of a different level of impact on different countries. Especially I noticed that for the poor countries, which of course I'm from Idea Center, we represented poor countries, is about the that Cambodia is going to take a minus 0.9, mm-hmm. and then Switzerland is going to be taking a minus 0.7, so mm-hmm. the highest, the lowest among all the targeted countries. So I mean, this brings us to a very serious question, which I think we could come back later, also listen to other panelists about how do we make sure that both the RTAs and also their interaction with multilateral trading system could be more inclusive and make sure that we have these spillovers concretized in the future measures. So with that, I will give floor to Anthony. I think he will bring us also a global picture, but also maybe a little bit of emphasis on Latin America. Thanks a lot. Anthony, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, you, for the and to the organizers for inviting us to this T20 conference. I'm going to do something a little bit similar to what Ulrich did, using a little bit old technology. So you'll see a little bit old pictures, and I'm going to be kind of a very simplistic presentation, because to me, I think one of the key questions of this particular forum is why we need to have this debate, an old debate, which has already been said is going on for more than 10 years or even more, on regionalism versus multilateralism in a different context. Why is it good to have this kind of debate in maybe in the context of the G20 or in other contexts? So I'm going to try to go to the very basics of the debate and try to understand why we need this other forums to have this discussion. And to do that, let me just give you if it works. Okay, this is better. Thank you very much. Let me just start with kind of the picture that we all have in our heads, which is this powerful picture on how trade has evolved in the last half century. And we take 94, always 95, as a good year, as a breaking point for, if you will, a little bit of an acceleration of this pattern of trade growing more than GDP for the last few decades. I'm sure the next session, and I know that Simon will probably talk a little bit about this, is what's going to happen beyond that. So I'm going to just focus in this the last 20 years, which I think we should keep in mind as the period in which we should have had this this discussion. And the questions I'm going to try to answer is why we need to care about this debate in a context outside the traditional context, which has been the WTO, and maybe bring it to the G20, and not as much on how we should care about this. What are the kind of the kind of more the nitty gritty questions that should be thinking about, which maybe others will elaborate. And I think there are two very basic facts that I think is always good to remind us of what type of evolution of regional agreements we had in the last 20 years. One is that this increasing number of FTAs or regional trade agreements, as you have seen some of the pictures, it's really embedded on the type of structural changes that we have seen in the economy in the last 20 years. It's a cause and consequence. It's part of it. It's just not something that came on the top of that, but it has to be understood as one of the key underlying structural changes in the last 20 years. And the second point, which I will make, again, very simple point, but I think it's very important to understand in this debate, is that when we talk about RTAs, FTAs, these are very different animals. It's a huge variance of what the type of objects that we are trying to analyze. They are similar in some source to the WTO system framework, but they are not in many other respects. So the comparison sometimes and the discussion becomes a little bit blurred when we try to do these two things. So on the first point, just very basic. Basic crystallized facts, which we all know, but I think is again good to remind, is what are the big changes that we have seen in the last 20 years that have a reflection in this growth of regional agreements. One is the growth of trade by developing countries. Today, compared to 20 years ago, 40% of trade involves some developing countries, and out of this 40%, almost half it's south-south trade. This is a completely different picture of what we had a few years back. This is, of course, very similar, much a little bit more complicated if you look at the FDI flows, but a little very similar the participation of developing economies into overall FDI flows, something that we didn't have in the 1990s. Related to that, as we know, and part of this participation of these developing countries in global trade, emerging economies, has been thanks to these possibilities that they have in participating in what we call global value change. But as you see in this picture, it's more regional value change, and there's a discussion about that. So there has been a regionalization of the fragmentation of the production. We like to talk about regional value change, especially when we look at areas like my region, Latin America, that looks like more Africa than what's happening in Eastern Europe and Asia. So there has been a regionalization of these fragmented production networks. And on the top of that, and that's, I think, again, the part of the connection of the picture, we have regulated these new patterns of trade, these new patterns of production, with the picture that Ulrich was showing, with some new technology, looking at the old technology. This is the type of regulatory framework that we have used in the last 20 years on the top of this. So this is a regionalization of the regulatory frameworks, regionalization of the production, and regionalization of some of the trade patterns. If you want to elaborate on this, and I'm going to go very fast, we are at the WTO, so everybody knows this very well, but the type of FTAs, the type of RTAs that we have seen in the last 20 years before and after 1995, 1994, are very different. These are what the WTO calls shallow FTAs, and accumulative, the new ones, the deep ones, this is what's also on Ulrich's graph, are the ones who have more complex provisions, again, appearing after 1994. And again, another structural change in the type of RTAs that we have seen is the parties involved. North-North were the norm before. We have seen more and more North-South agreements, and of course the South-South increase of RTAs. So it's different, completely a different structure of type of agreements. So this is just the first point. Again, very, very basic point, but RTAs have to be seen as one very important element and explanation of these changes of the structural global economy in the last 20 years. Here I have some pictures, very simple pictures also, to make the second point, which is that RTAs are very different animals. They are different only looking at the trade component. So if you look only at the trade part, the trade liberalization part, they are extremely different in the way they liberalize trade, in the way they structure some of the regulations. But of course, they are also very different in the type of objectives that they attempt beyond trade. Many of these RTAs go beyond trade goals, and we can discuss this more in length later. So they cannot be understood unless we link the trade objective, the trade liberalization objective, with a non-trade functional type of cooperation that they also have embedded in the agreements or in ad hoc agreements. This is a picture for Latin America, which we think that is a very relatively well connected, has been one of the precursors in RTAs. These are the links between the ones who have RTAs and the ones who don't have, of course dominated by the Caribbean and Central America, who have not been able to connect through RTAs with the rest of the partners in the hemisphere. This is with just looking at the number of agreements. You can look at the trade intensity. These two graphs are not comparable. Actually, the existing agreements graph, which means the trade that is happening with FTAs that have already been negotiated and implemented, this graph represents 80% of total intra-regional trade, means that 80% of trade intra-region in Latin America is covered by some sort of FTA. The rest of the 20% is missing links, trade that has not been yet negotiated under a free trade agreement, and the relative sizes responds to the 80 and to the 20 and to the 20%. So the point here is just that there's still a lot of missing links in a region that has been done a lot of agreements among themselves, but also of course with other partners. If you look a little bit more in depth at how the liberalization has happened in Latin America, and I think this applies probably to other regions of the world, there's a very simple way of looking at. And I think, you know, to look at the region today in 2016, you know, in light of the Article 24 and other kind of provisions of the WTO regarding free trade agreements, it's very interesting what has happened. If you look at just the tariff lines for those agreements that have been already negotiated, we have achieved the 90% mark. For those agreements that are today being implemented in Latin America, almost 100% of the tariff lines are duty-free. If you measure this in trade, it also has passed the line of 90% from 1994, when these agreements, most of them started, they were just basically non-duty-free. If you compute another interesting figure, which is, let's look now at all the trade in the region under FTAs and under non-negotiated, the missing links, this trade, of course, is much, much lower. It does not reach even the 75% mark. So it means that 75% of trade, only 75% of all total trade in the region, covered and non-covered by FTAs, is today free. But of course, it's a huge achievement in terms of what has happened through RTAs in terms of trade liberalization in one particular region without anything happening at the WTO. These are regional averages. I'm not going to talk about if there's a lot of variation on how this has been achieved by different FTAs, by different RTAs. You can look at different groupings. I just have here some examples, whether you measure in terms of tariff, whether you measure in terms of trade. The other aspect that has been already mentioned is the variation, and I'm not going to discuss this in detail, but there's a lot of variation, what we call families of rules of origin that have been used to access these preferential markets, with some similarities among some agreements, but not, there's no similarity in the region in the way that rules of origin have been negotiated. It's more like a group of different families. We can talk about why is that. And also maybe, and I'm not going to get into here, if you look at other disciplines, other type of provisions that appear in these agreements, there's a huge variation in the number and the type of disciplines that are covered. Again, the point here is that these RTAs are very different animals only when you look at the type of the way they do trade liberalization, not to say that there's lots of difference when you look at the other functions that they try to perform as a regional grouping. Mercosur is a very different animal of what the Pacific Alliance is. Both of them has a huge important component on trade liberalization in different ways, but they try to perform other types of cooperation functions in the regions that go well beyond the WTO framework or the trade framework in general. So just to finish, just three questions that I think have been already in the table from the first session. One is how to how best to close the remaining missing links, both globally and in our particular case in this region. We definitely close a lot of these missing links. We definitely achieve a lot of tariff and kind of the traditional tariff liberalization in the region through these RTAs. We really clear have done that in the case of Latin America. The second question is how to promote convergence, and I add here coherence. You know, there's a difference here in concept. Once you have this complex web of agreements, how you go about promoting some sort of convergence and coherence? Should you do it at the multilateral level? Should you promote this at the bilateral level? There's very interesting examples. For example, in the case of the Pacific Alliance, how this has been done at the sub-regional level, how this can be taken up at a much more global level. And third, and I think this is just repeating the what I just said, but I think it's one very important point on why some of these debates should be taken out of this kind of only Geneva base, which is that some of these agreements, especially these RTAs, want to implement other type of complementary policies. Some of these agreements are negotiated side by side with other issues regarding physical connectivity at the regional level. There are issues of trade facilitation at the regional level. There are issues of non-trade integration. Financial integration is, for example, something that is becoming important in our region, which was not there a few years back, or more issues about the sustainability. And just one, again, a small advertising also. This is a platform that the bank is trying to promote. ICTSD is a partner, all of the institutions as a partner. A lot of what's happening, I think, is lack of, not only lack of analysis, there's a lot of lack of information. I'm just trying to show you that the diversity, the variance that we have requires much more in-depth analysis than the one that we have, and much more in-depth analysis and information that is required to make some of these decisions. And I'll finish. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Anthony, for your presentation and also for the highly relevant questions. Of course, I understand that you have actually a few years ago tried to provide answers to those questions in one of your papers. I mean, in 2013, in one of your papers, you have proposed some measures to be taken so as to enhance this coherence between RTAs and a multilateral trading system, including to set up a kind of RTA exchange and use that tool transparency to facilitate multilateralization of RTA disciplines and best practice. And also the multilateralization itself should be enabled by reforms in the WTO itself. I think there are many things we remain ready maybe to listen to afterwards in the Q&A process. So with that, I'll give floor to Said, and who will also present us a nice picture about the global picture of RTAs, I understand. Thanks, Said.
Okay, it's a pleasure for me to be here with you, and of course I would like to thank you to organizing institutions for this timely event, and also for the WTO for hosting this event. There are several questions which are interrelated for session two, starting with the main one: how to ensure that the proliferation of regional trade agreements and now mega regional agreements strengthens multilateral trading system. Maybe we can reformulate the question I just reformulated to ask: how could the WTO strengthen the mega regional trade agreements to keep them more in the multilateral side? I mean, have to curb the challenges that these initiatives can bring into the multilateral system. I have some very humble ideas on these, but I will just go through, first of all, how we develop the intellectual ideas about the regionals and multilateralism. Of course, there are several graphs that we can produce. This is one of them. The RTAs are recurrently proliferating. Well, they continue as trade growth rises, and they continue as trade growth declines after 2008. So what are they for? This is not my basic question today, but just to make a reference to Professor Lehmann for this morning, is there any gap that they can fill in governing between technology and markets and what's going on now today with respect to the problems of global trade today? Well, we don't know. Of course, they have such ambitions and very big ambitious mega regionals we have today. And all these have sometimes having such ambitious ideas of being game changers. So what does it mean? And of course, there had been several explanations for the motivations of RTAs. I will not go through all of these, but what I can say is that every motive is developed as a response to something, maybe to the negotiating and rulemaking functions of the WTO system. So, but whatever it is, the motivation, a better regulation of RTAs is a necessity. Because there are implications for non-members, they have diversionary effects, and that the WTO, for the WTO, it may be a source of concern. Anyway, so how the debate evolved, starting with very early 1990s, concerning, everybody remembers the building and stumbling blocks debate based on the spaghetti ball effect. Then we had the very brilliant idea of multilateralizing regionalism. Of course, the regionalism is here to stay. And the focus on the gains from coherence between multilateralism and regionalism is a must. Then we had very good ideas about what will be the implications for third countries if we have, especially in the post-mega RTAs period, the indirect spillovers. Ulrich mentioned some of them when third countries purposefully adopt the regulatory standards and procedures of these mega RTAs. And then we had a very nice study by Jos Paulin, who will be here in the afternoon, the mega RTA as a provider of public goods. Well, they can somehow, for some reasons, why they explains the reasons why TTIP specifically as a mega RTA, TTIP concessions may leak or to benefit also to third countries. I'm not sure whether this happens automatically. We need some more efforts to provide these leakage and benefit for the third countries. So embarked on these ideas, maybe we should have more debate, especially within the context of T20, and to bring more intellectual ideas about how WTO could play a role in this process of providing these indirect spillovers for third countries, at least to make them the mega regionals more functioning and more in line with the multilateral system. Well, of course, we have to, first of all, remember the main challenges posed by the mega RTAs. They have two parts, diversionary effects, as we all know. Well, preferential tariffs, they're getting down all the tariffs, so the preferential effect will be minimal. Not for all countries, of course. So it changes from one country to the other. The second aspect is the negative spillovers, what I call as sometimes complying with these standards of mega markets is not very easy and may raise the production costs, what I call as the compliance cost for third countries in terms of standards, environmental and labor standards for the sake of leveling playing field or IPR, etc. So how could we help the non-members to achieve positive spillovers then? Of course, the problems, just to make it more clear, could be to solve a very old problem, growing complexity of the rules of origin. And of course, the 21st century issues like regulatory cooperation, how to achieve this, because we know that there are empirical studies also indicated that TTIP reduces trade in NAFTA, in Turkey EU trade, and even within the European Union, Germany's trade with the southern members like Greece, Italy, Spain. So we have to be cautious in accepting that the standards as global standards that are set up only by the EU and the United States, but who sets the rules are as important matters as much as the rules themselves. So how to be more inclusive in developing and providing more coherence and regulatory cooperation in that sense. An inclusive approach, that's one of the ideas to make the inclusiveness in the G20 meetings. But within that context, I put the inclusiveness as being an open regionalism, but how to provide accession and docking for third countries. not necessarily being members of the system, of the RTA, but how they can achieve positive spillovers. So that's true that an exclusive trading bloc with a close membership will not be contributing to the multilateral trade system, that's for sure. So how about the mega regionals then? For TPP, yes, it's theoretically could be open to any APEC member, but is it so an automatic accession for China? I don't know. For TTIP, well, there are many explanations, but just as a case for Turkey, for example, the quest for Turkey's quest for membership to TTIP is not very welcomed, and it's not very clear in which ways Turkey can dock itself into this system. Yet an open mega RTA still may not attract some members. On the other hand, if the precondition is to adopt all the acquis, but it's not a very easy process. So what policy options we have for third countries, that has also been debated very heavily in the literature, in intellectual circles, to make the WTO again, revive the WTO system and engage with multilateral regulatory agenda. That's not very easy. It has, if it has been easy, then we would have a much successful Doha round. So engage with plurilaterals. That could be one way, of course, but plurilaterals only for specific sectoral issues. So how about regionals? Well, I'm not sure. I agree with what previously Professor Simon Evans said. A dominant regionalism may not be the case, and may not work, or sometimes make the things even more messy. A rival RTAs could also make the things more complicated. So countries are expected to have domestic unilateral reforms to raise up their standards so that they can have access to RTA mega markets, but how to comply with the standards. That's a very costly and lengthy procedure that I think the WTO and in these circles in T20 we should bring more fresh ideas on how we can achieve such steps to make the spillovers more feasible and manageable for third countries. So the WTO could be used as a provider for global public goods in providing this, in assisting. For example, the WTO assists in mitigating the negative spillovers and boosting positive spillovers. And it could start a discussion for less stringent regulatory measures, whether through the mutual recognition agreements or not, and review its principles in reducing diversionary effects. And of course, measures the impact of mega RTAs more accurately. Just to say a few words for each, and then I will stop. Maybe we need a chapter in every mega RTA on multilateralization. In that chapter, to discuss the methods to encourage member states to include at least this kind of chapter. For RTAs which comes above a certain threshold of global trade, should provide evidences at least how to blunt trade diversion or mechanisms by which the accession could be possible for third countries. Sometimes it's not very clear. And impact assessment analysis should be made regularly because we cannot all of a sudden measure all the impact, but we need some time, of course, for some events to happen. And mechanisms for third countries to adopt global standards, that goes to regulatory cooperation. And maybe an RTA adjustment facility to compensate non-members, especially the developing and least developed countries, in improving their capacities to adapt higher standards. And these beneficiaries can be determined according to certain criteria for which the WTO committee on the RTAs could work on. And of course, this facility should use methods for regulatory cooperation. Maybe a separate body or a council could be established for regulatory cooperation, and more open consultative mechanisms are necessary to hear the voice of third parties in their difficulties achieving higher standards. That has been a case for Turkey, for example, during its customs union process, where Turkey had some kind of cooperation with the EU in aligning the European standards. But sometimes even this mechanism does not work very efficiently. So therefore, this consultative mechanism under regulatory cooperation is quite an important one. And of course, less stringent and more flexible rules of origin for third countries that allows accumulation principle beyond maybe a product by product basis. And we should also consider whether changes in that occurs in the headings or in the change of the chapters, which one is more stringent or not. That's an important item. And of course, we have as far as rules of origin are concerned, listing some significant third countries that has a substantial trade in inputs with the US, with EU, with protagonists of the TTIP or other mega regionals is quite important, because they are very deeply integrated into the global value chains or the value chains. And of course, a modeling on the pan-Europe Mediterranean accumulation system could be assessed for that purpose. And finally, the impact assessment reports. We have a lot of impact assessment reports. And sometimes we all know that these impact assessment reports really say something, but may differ the case from one country to the other. But we need reports, a more standardized assessment for mega regionals that could be done or studied at WTO level, which could include a wider elaboration to consider economic, social, environmental, human rights, and institutional aspects. By institutional, I also mean the impact on the WTO system. Well, the TPRM is a good exercise, which could also informally be started for mega regionals then to review what goes on in these mega regionals, just like in the member states of the WTO. I would like to thank you, and I've finish it now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Said. I think your presentation nicely brings us to a deeper discussion about how do we deal with this coherence issue. Many things you have proposed, like this kind of transparency mechanism, and also a chapter in each mega regionals for multilateralization, and also accession for potential non-members, and also RTA adjustment facilities, so on and so forth. All are very nice ideas. Of course, before we go to that step, one key question is that where do we establish those? I mean, this is also a key question that we have proposed for this discussion. I mean, naturally, we would say it will be in the WTO in this house. And then we have a question about who should initiate, how big the coverage, and who will take the decisions. We understand that always that for many years, WTO even started discussing the transparency mechanism, and to discuss that where we start about which chapters on various RTAs, be it on investment, be it on tariff reduction. We got stuck for years before we could even put her forward, at least. And to be frank, I was also part of this nasty gangster against a kind of smooth start of that discussion. But I mean, there are many things we need to look at back into this house and to see how this house should change so as we could get some ideas of your ideas and others into the kind of discussion in the house. So with that, I'll give the floor to Sean. I think he will give some very nice, how interesting presentation on some of the issues we have discussed about how big players should play their role in this discussion. Thank you, Sean. You take the floor.
Thank you. So you're right. I will speak first about our research on a U.S.-China free trade agreement, or bringing free trade between the U.S. and China. And then I'm going to connect that to the broader discussion on mega-regional agreements and multilateralism. So I'll start with our book, Bridging the Pacific Toward Free Trade and Investment Between China and the United States. I'll say that it was written for a time when China and U.S. relations were better and less anti-trade sentiment was in the U.S. U.S. and Chinese demeanors have actually switched, and now China is pushing for more free trade while the U.S. is moving towards isolationism. And you can see that China's push for multilateralism in their recent five-year plan, where they state clearly that they want to strengthen the multilateral trading system. And even recently, they've called for a multilateral agreement on services. So about the book, our colleagues ran an economic model looking at the economic gains of a comprehensive FTA, I'll note, between China and the U.S., including more than $100 billion in income gains for the U.S. and more than $300 billion for China, productivity gains of 1% and 2% respectively, and significant export gains for both countries, the U.S. notably in services. So in the book, we also have a table, a very interesting table, looking at the export gains under alternative FTAs. And as you can see on China's row, under an expanded TPP, what we call TPP 16, China actually loses a little bit of trade diversion effects to TPP countries. These are relatively small, as Ulrich mentioned, the spillovers, the negative effects are rather smart, but the symbolism is there in that China will be missing out. And if you compound that with the potential trade gains of a US FTA, which what we call CHSTIA, China-US trade agreement, China could get another $400 billion. So the net position there could be that China is losing out from more than half a trillion in exports from not being in TPP or not having free trade agreement between China and the U.S. You can also see from a free trade area of the Asia-Pacific, China has tremendous gains on exports, and these are annual gains after 10 years of implementation. So a free trade agreement between China and the U.S. Would be historic in two senses. It would bring the world's two largest economies together and a pair of geopolitical rivals whose overall relationship is a crucial force in regional and global security. It also will help with both countries' rebalancing goals, China from manufacturing to services, and also from its investment-led economy to one more of a consumer-led economy. And the U.S. on the other side, increasing investment and increasing its savings rate while also increasing exports. I'll note here again that the gains you saw are reliant on comprehensive services liberalization by China. That's why the gains are so high. And without that, you would not see nearly as much gains as predicted. But the bright side of that would be that this would significantly decrease the bilateral trade deficit that the U.S. has with China. Now, why would China's view on the TPP has actually changed over the last year? And so I want to look a little bit at why China's attitude has changed. And I'll say that a lot of it has to do with competitive liberalization, the prospect of trade diversion, and shifting supply chains has made China think again about joining a mega regional that includes the U.S. China's own study by a state-sanctioned think tank shows significant negative effects from a TPP, which China is not included. This fear of being left behind can effectively persuade countries who were hesitant to agree to include frontier issues to have them sign up. This may be the best way to protect against new protectionist measures and undertake pro-market reforms. Of course, in the multilateral system, they can simply block what they don't find favorably. Regional plurilateral agreements are essential to maintain the momentum for trade liberalization, especially with the slowing trade growth, as we'll hear in the next session. But I'll also say bilateral trade agreements seem to be slowing a bit, and the U.S. trade ambassador has noted recently that the U.S. is currently not interested in pursuing bilateral trade deals. But broader liberalization initiatives like TPP and TISA have a large gap in them, in that without China's participation, there is a significant amount of gains missing. It is essential that China be allowed to join these agreements if it can agree to the high standards of the agreements. And the best chance for China to agree to embrace these frontier issues like e-commerce, state-owned enterprises, and labor and environment will be through regional trade agreements like the TPP. The issues of e-commerce have been noted significantly in the TPP. And also, I'll just say a brief bit about state-owned enterprise conditions in the TPP, which were used as the basis for the SOE conditions in the TISA negotiations. The SOE conditions in TPP are not actually against SOEs, and actually they're not against subsidies per se. They are against subsidies that cause market distorting effects against other firms, notably foreign firms. And there are also very important provisions on transparency in there, including financial disclosures and disclosures on current and former government officials in high level and high upper management positions. These conditions are subject to dispute settlement, but I also know I think that these are in line with China's reform goals, and that they want to make SOEs more competitive. Well, these rules will level the playing field for China, for Chinese SOEs and worldwide SOEs, and also bringing China in further into an agreement with including environmental standards, such as the reduction of subsidies that go to environmentally harmful industries, and a commitment to advancing low emissions economic growth. Once China agrees to these conditions, it could be a wake up for other developing countries. So the path for these future issues noted here will also go through the regionalism and plurilaterals, such as rules for trade and investment in cyberspace, development of rules on trade remedies, which is unlikely in the WTO, and stronger currency agreements, possibly inside agreements like agreed to in the TPP. And I'll sum up with a couple of conclusions. As Saeed noted, maybe part of the question could be changed to how could the WTO strengthen mega-regionals or regional trade agreements? And I think could establish an information hub within the WTO with a global mandate to disseminate best practices in order to facilitate the development of converging competition policies, harmonization of technical standards, rolling back protectionist measures, especially local content requirements, conditions on SOEs, and trade adjustment assistance. The EU, US, and China should lead efforts in the WTO to provide rules for regional trade agreements. This could be something like having simple rules for rules of origin or the amount of tariff liberalization. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. I think your presentation touches upon a subject which has been weighing heavily on a lot of people in this house, is about the leadership role of the two big guys, China and the US. And I mean, your presentation, we could there are some questions we could always ask. Is first about China-US FTA looks like a love story. I mean, is that feasible in the near future, given the high attention across the Pacific in between the two countries? The second thing is that what do we mean by talking about the two big guys begin to negotiate for their bilateral FTA? and how does that mean for the multilateral training system and their leadership role here? Quite a few years ago in this house, I was also participating in a seminar about the multilateral training system and by RTAs, and I was metaphorizing the negotiations, trade negotiations, like a sports. I always say that a WTO negotiation is like basketball, and then RTAs is like football. And for quite some time, we're seeing a destruction of basketball players going to the soccer court. And of course, we know that sometimes coach ask the basketball players to play soccer for a while, just to get relaxed and then less emotional, and they come back more nimble and more focused to make the basketball fun, more fun. But right now, we don't know. We are seeing a kind of suspicion that probably the basketball players are really leaving the court and then picking up the football and try to make that their future job. We know that for the U.S., the ambassador is already the chief negotiator for TTIP. And Chinese vice minister in charge in the MOFCOM, he's covering also RTAs. And what I see is that he's flying around more for bilateral FTAs instead of for WTO negotiations. So I mean that's a heavy question on us, because I think it has always been publicly said here, unless these two big guys resolve issues among them too, and then we cannot see a meaningful movement here in the WTO. So I mean, of course, we could discuss always further. But with that, I will give floor to Clara, and who has been a keen observer, both on RTAs. I know you have written a lot on IPA and other mega-regionals, and also we have benefited a lot from some of your recent papers about WTO negotiations. I know that the system and this house remains as dear to you as to me and many others. And in one of your papers, you say that the Doha is dead and long live the WTO. So we'll listen to how we could make sure that the WTO lives longer than in Jean-Pierre's lifetime. Yeah, please.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. It's a huge pleasure to be here and discuss with all of you in the room and with you on the panel, and to reflect upon regionalism and multilateralism here on the premises of the WTO, at the very heart of the multilateral system. Reflecting on coherence and transparency. In my view, and that's one of my main messages today, both the coherence and the transparency debate should take account of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, adopted by the global community in 2015. Global trade governance should be coherent with the 2030 Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals enshrined in the agenda, and there should be improved coherence and transparency, which would contribute to successfully achieving its objectives. And in all of this, the G20 can play a key role. So let's start with coherence. The 2030 Agenda calls for sustainable development to be at the core of global cooperation, including in the context of international trade. For example, it calls for a non-discriminatory global trading system, and that's one of the key challenges we're discussing here today. What could the role of the G20 be? We need to bridge the gap between the realities of the global trading system, and we heard a lot about this just now, and the aspirations of the 2030 Agenda, and that's a challenge. The G20 is an important player that can help bridge that gap and foster the implementation of the 2030 Agenda and improve the coherence. This is even more compelling since the G20 is being chaired by two countries this year, next year, China and Germany, that have both put a strong focus on fostering both the multilateral trading system and who are proponents of the 2030 Agenda. We already heard that an additional challenge to coherence is the rise of mega-regionals. due to their sheer size, mega-regionals have global effects, and we saw many more detailed data on that earlier, both on third countries and on the global trading system at large. This is also relevant for coherence with the view to the Agenda 2030 and for transparency concerns, because of course excluded countries wonder about the rules that are being set that shape the future of the global trading system. So coherence with the 2030 agenda, what could the G20 do? I have 5 points on the slides that the G20 could pick up. First of all, the G20 should emphasize that global trade governance should be conducive to fostering the implementation of the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. So it should underline that this is an important goal. More particularly, the G20 could propose a WTO General Council interpretive statement that calls on WTO practice to interpret and to promote trade rules such that they are in line and conducive to fostering the 2030 agenda. Number three, the G20 could call for a clarification of the exemptions of GATT Article 20 to permit states to implement sustainability measures with less concern that they are in violation of multilateral trade rules. Fourthly, the G20 should call, and we heard about this earlier, for a more systematic global sustainability impact analysis of proposed regional trade agreements. And we heard that this should be a standardized approach to be comparable across the board. The G20 could play an important role in fostering this proposal. Number five, the G20 should promote trade rules that contribute to towards supporting the 2030 agenda, for example, by joining the Environmental Goods Agreement or by providing duty and quota-free market access for LDCs. We already heard that it's important to make sure that mega-regionals are as inclusive as possible and generate positive spillovers for third countries. And that's even more important from the perspective of the 2030 agenda. And I second, together with my colleague Axel from the German Development Institute, I second all the proposals that have been put on the table by Ulrich and also Said earlier today to try to make sure that mega-regionals are inclusive in that sense and can provide positive spillovers to third countries. And I think the proposals made, which are on the slide here again, should also be reflected upon in the context of the G20 process if the coherence between regionalism and multilateralism is to be an important issue on the agenda. Moving on to transparency. There's a need for more transparency. I think all of us agree in this room that this is the case. We know that existing information on RTAs is incomplete and uncoordinated at this point. There's a need for a better understanding of the content and of experiences with RTAs, especially because this can contribute to promoting coherence with multilateralism. It can also help build on innovations and lessons learned in the context of RTAs. It can help us think about how we can multilateralize RTAs. And that's something that we could discuss later on. And it can foster analysis of the sustainable development impact of RTAs. And that, in turn, can foster coherence with this 2030 agenda on sustainable development. So there's clearly a need for more transparency. I think all of us agree. So which proposals are on the table? I list three to remind us what's on the table and what could be different routes to go down and to follow. First of all, one proposal is to transform the current provisional transparency mechanism for RTAs into a permanent one, and this is reaffirmed by the Nairobi Declaration. Moreover, it could be possible to try to boost the WTO's mandate and capacity to conduct an self-initiated and independent policy examinations of every notified RTA or PTA. This seems a bit challenging and ambitious to be put in practice, and that's why it's great to hear that the third proposal, namely an RTA exchange, is already being put into practice by partners including IADB and ICTSD, because an RTA exchange that fosters information and research on trade agreements and is made publicly accessible is a great way to foster transparency. So we're looking forward to more on the RTA exchange emerging in the future. So what could the G20 do in that context? The G20 should help to foster transparency because there's a need for more information on RTAs to help to improve the coherence with the multilateral system. And the G20, and this was mentioned earlier by Dennis Noah, the G20 should reflect on guiding principles to coordinate negotiations at different levels. We haven't talked much about proliferation yet, but that's of course a key component of the future global trading system. And one option would be for the G20 to look more closely at plurilateral negotiations and agreements and to speak out in favor of clarifying the principles and procedures for plurilaterals. Multilateralism should be the cornerstone of the global trade system, but if multilateralism and multilateral agreements are not feasible, the focus could be on plurilaterals built into the WTO system. Plurilaterals should not only be built into the WTO system, but should also be based on MFN principles and include an open architecture to be open to accession. So they should only be part of the WTO system or under the roof of the WTO system if they comply with certain criteria such as these. So the main takeaway message is that both the debate about multilateralism and regionalism in the WTO, in the G20 and beyond it, should take account of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development and how to achieve better coherence in global economic governance. And the G20 can play a key role in that regard, and I hope to have outlined a few starting points for the debate how this could be done. Thanks very much for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Clara. I think those kind of more focused discussion on what G20 could play its role in fostering the discussion here and also within this house are very enlightening ideas. I'm sure our Chinese colleagues will bring these sensible proposals back to Beijing and to share that with other G20 players. Because I think before the meeting, we have been discussing informally about what the role of G20 and about whether G20 is the source of the problem or is trying to help the problem. And our conclusion is that it's both. And G20 is not playing its role in the house and outside of the house. And of course, it's trying to help, but how far could they go and could bring our attention back to this house, I think remains a key question. I think your proposals will be highly valued for that. So without further ado, I'll give the floor to the last speaker, Dr. Kim, and he has been a keen observer also on many, one of his expertises on regional integration has been studying a lot and writing many books and about the regional integration both in Asia as well as between Asia and Europe, as far as I understand. And I think that will benefit a lot from his expertise, especially on how we could further the discussion by Clara about this coherence and transparency issue, and so as to make sure we have a complementarity between the regionals and the multinationals. Please, Kim, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for your very kind introduction, and thank you for having me in this very, very interesting forum. Well, today, I'd like to raise just two questions which are related to the how to strengthen regulatory coherence and transparency of RTA. So first, let me talk about the coherence issues. I'd like to raise the talk about the multilateralism and the regionalism in these, two decades. And then I'd like to talk about the multilateralization of the bilaterals and the plurilaterals. I think that is one of the most important things that we need to think about, revisit this multilateralization of the bilaterals or plurilaterals. So first, so many talks about the rules of origin, and I'd like to talk about this rules of origin and issues again. And then, we have a kind of the possible solution of the removing or alleviating the negative impacts of the spaghetti bowl impact is to make it easier for third parties to join. The targeting RTA is a preference scheme without sacrificing the principle of a PT, preferential trade agreement. So maybe there are a couple of the methods proposed to alleviate this kind of spaghetti bowl impact. especially in the bilateral FTAs. First, I mean, outdoor processing is widely applied to make use of the third party's contribution to the value chain without sacrificing preferential treatment. But this approach is, in a sense, a limited remedy and thus leads to the limited impact on trade, as it confines the applicable place and items for the processing for to a certain degree. Let me take the many examples of the limitation of outdoor processing, especially in the case of the Korea with other countries' FTA. And second, tolerance rules is widely introduced, and it's true that they have a positive impact on increasing trade, but the limitation of this tolerance rule is that they essentially imply the allowing exceptions, and thus it is quite difficult to apply this rule in a comprehensive way in the FTAs. So towards the multilateralization, proliferation of the bilateral FTAs, I'd like to propose the change in cumulative method of rules of origin. So most of the worldwide RTAs currently adopt the bilateral accumulation of rules of origin, as most of the RTAs are bilaterals, to invigorate the supply chain trade. So this rules of origin should no longer become an instrumental of restrictiveness regarding the world trade. So the EU has made exceptional use of the diagonal accumulation of rules of origin as it applies to the pan-euro MED. So in the EU, the diagonal accumulation has been more or less used as a tool for GSP, but the partner countries of diagonal rules of origin are developing countries in the Mediterranean. If this rule can be applied to the EU-Asia preferential trade agreements, so a combination of the least developed countries and more developed Asian economies can create good alternatives. And this is, I think, that's one of the practical approach that the existing bilaterals can be multilateralized, or we can alleviate the limitation of the rules of origin now. So maybe there are many, I can raise the proposed many examples, such as the we have completed, the EU has completed the FTAs with Vietnam, and Korea has the FTAs with EU, and Korea has also the FTAs with Vietnam. And in that case, there are three bilaterals. So we have many bilaterals like this, and all the rules of origin are different. And this kind of rules of origin are quite burdensome for the three parties, the trading parties. And then maybe we can apply this kind of the within the rules of origin to the different criteria of rules of origin to the many bilaterals. And then I think that that is related to the second issues, but WTO, where we ask so many things to the WTO what the WTO should do, but I think that the WTO need to be more focused and more active role in the plurilateral and the bilateral FTAs in the future. So, and the second thing is about this is related to transparency issues. I hope that the WTO must play a more active role in the bilateral and plurilateral. WTO is a strong proponent of the multilateral liberalization. Yeah, all of us agree, but we need to, I think that WTO could make there some more roles on the induce the bilateral and the plurilaterals to the more the loyal to the principle of the multilateral liberalizations. For instance, trade policy reviews can mechanism can make the some kind of peer review, and we can analyze most of the deep FTAs. Let alone the sheer FTAs, the deep FTAs compare issue by issues, such as including the new issues, so-called state-owned enterprise, or e-commerce, or investment, or sustainable development issues. All the issue by issues, we can analyze or compare more than 100 FTAs, bilateral FTAs and RTAs, and then maybe can give a comparison to something like to make the scoreboard, and how far your RTAs are different from others. Then maybe we can, that is, I think, the starting point to to think about how to enhance the level of the FTAs to the more deep FTAs. So I think that maybe the G20s can raise this kind of additional role to the WTO this year or the next year. And then lastly, I want to talk about the previous presenter's presentation. I mean, Sean talks about the very nice story about the United States and the China FTA. And in your analysis, the impact of this FTA on Korea is something like negative. But I don't think so. I think if I am the Korean trade policymakers, I would strongly, propose these big FTAs. Because I mean, I think that Korea and China and U.S. FTAs can be one of the exemplary FTA that indirect impact, a big indirect impact on others, the third parties, in terms of the sustainable development, in terms of the dispute settlement, in terms of the intellectual property right, and many other issues as well. So maybe if the United States-China FTA is established, it can be a kind of stepping stone for other third parties like the Korea can revise our existing FTAs with China, and also our existing FTAs with the United States, and then all of the other things. And the last thing is about the TTIP. And Korea is the one of the unique country, I think, that established the FTA with the EU and the United States. And then also the general analysis is something like this TTIP can lead to quite a negative impact on the other third parties. And one of the things that I want to point out is that the so-called global standard on services and regulatory things. When we are talking about the FTA negotiation with the United with the EU, so many standard, especially in the automobiles and then chemistries and then the intellectual property rights. The EU's standard, EU argued that the EU standard is a global standard, so Korea adopted this standard. There was argument from the EU, and then but there was no rationale of why this standard is better than the Korean standard. The 28 countries that abide by this rule, and then it's more convenient for Korea to move, not the EU. So there was something like the definition of global standard. So, but the moving require cost. Okay, so if Korea move, then this means that Korea have more burden and to more cost. So, if the United States or the EU want other countries to abide by the global standard, then you should consider at the cost. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Kim. I think you bring us to a kind of a serious question about how do we make sure that different FTAs and the different standards, including such as you mentioned, the EU standards on IP could be kind of spread out to others and to be followed. Of course, that corresponds to some other presentations by saying that where do we do it and how do we do it, be it a kind of a more thorough analysis within WTO independently on those mega regionals and RTAs, and as well as on how do we develop a kind of best practice out of it, and then to see whether we could spread it out to other FTAs, be it kind of global standard. But of course, that is something we remains to see on whether this house would change in to an extent that they would welcome that initiative. Well, I thank all the panelists for your kind of highly valuable presentations. And because of the time issue, I won't humbly do any kind of takeaways or summarization. I'm too humble and psychologically constrained to do that within the time. Instead, I will reserve some minutes to the questions and answers. And then finally, I maybe give 1.5 minutes for each of you to make a conclusion remarks. And I'm sure the audience is eager to ask questions. So With that, I would see if you are not too hungry, who would start first? Any questions? Yeah, please please identify yourself yourself and be brief on questions or comments, if any. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, the chairman, and I appreciate all your presentation, and I have learned a lot from you. I have a question or comments to the Mr. SCHOOF. You have mentioned you have two empirical analysis on the effect of the mega trade deals. I have also done some of work on this field, and some of them have already published in the like the world economy, the economic modeling, and the journal of comparative economics. And you do not tell us about a specific calcul methodology or what you have using. And I think you are using the computational general equilibrium policy modeling and simulation method. So, and from your result, we can see that the mega trade deal effect to all the other countries is not very severe, or is weak from your simulation. So, what my comments and suggestion is that I don't know what you are doing to explore this effect. I mean, the present mega trade deal, they are focused on the long tariff reduction and elimination field. So, we know that it is so hard to do in the simulation. So what you are doing on this field? Especially on the long tariff barriers. So what you are doing, I mean, like the competition policy, intellectual property, and the environmental policies, and the labor standard policies, what you are doing? What is the effect? How do you evaluate this effect? I think it's a little hard to do. In our work, we are calculating the trade cost, and then divide them to the tariff and the long tariff. And just give some assumptions on how the long tariff reduction and explore their effects. And the second point is that about the welfare effect calculation. I don't know what you are doing. I know that we can calculate with the direct welfare, and maybe also with the Higgs, EV and CV equivalent variation and compensation variation effect. So I don't know what you are doing. And in our paper, we also have used the Debreu distance. It's very important, and this paper have published in the Econometrica in the 15 years ago, but none of the papers have calculated numerically, and our paper have do that. I mean that if you use different welfare indicators to calculate the results, it's different. This is the second. This is the second comment. The third is that the. I think when we exploring the effect of mega deals, regionalism, maybe we can think that what is the effect of the multilateral, I mean, for the TPP or the TTIP, we assume that all these reductions, tariff and long-tariff reductions, we explore this effect. Maybe we can extend to see if this same long-tariff and tariff and long-tariff reduction take place in the multilateral scope, I mean, for in the worldwide. So what is the effect? We have to do this kind of work and find that the multilateralism is much better, and the effect is much better, and it can benefit most of the countries in the world. So if this extension is feasible and it can be done, I think it's good. So, okay, that's all. Thank you.
Before I take out the questions, just one quick word to Uli, that because I happen to be a Chinese too. When Dr. Li says that I don't know what you are doing, it's not a criticism, it's not provocative. It just means he is eager to learn how your methodology about those things. So just to make sure that we don't have problems. Yeah. It's a cultural difference. So any more questions? If not, probably Uli, you could start, and then while the audience is reflecting upon what questions they could ask and later, please. Uli.
Yeah, there were a lot of methodological questions, and I would probably say let us talk later when we grab a coffee, and then I can provide you with most of the question. Basically, maybe just one thought is basically we are working with the model that is developed by the IFO Institute Munich. And this is a gravitational model and structural equation model, as you mentioned it. We're using the GTAP data, and what is, of course, the difference basically to the model from ECORIS, which is used by the European Commission, is that it's to some extent some kind of top-down approach, that we are not really assessing non-tariff trade barriers and equivalence with surveys, but that we are just applying that in the model is what the model is doing is just applying let's say knowledge and experience what we have from a similar big trade agreements in the past, and then we actually apply those trade reduction costs that we have seen to this kind of deep comprehensive free trade agreement for TTIP or shallow ones. So on the different scenarios. So this is basically what the model is doing. But it has been published also. The model itself has been published also in the scientific literature, and I can provide you with some kind of complete manual on it, yeah, and then we can discuss it later on as well. Okay,
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Uli, for that. And any more questions? Yeah, Ambassador Aaron, please.
Thank you. I mean, just to break the ice, others would follow. The concept of plurilateral agreements has been circulated a lot, especially in the morning session and now today. Both Said and Clara has mentioned briefly on how would this be affecting the multilateral or affecting the global trading system, and how WTO could take part in it in a way. So I just wonder whether there are other panelists would like to comment on that. Thank you.
So Said and Clara, would you two like to start? Maybe Clara first.
Yeah. You mentioned this saying that the Doha round is dead. Long live the WTO. I think we all agree that the WTO remains a key pillar in the global economy and in global governance, and it remains a provider of key functions such as dispute settlement. And also information dissemination on international trade. If the WTO wants to remain a central forum for trade negotiations, then the question is, how could this be achieved? And this is a huge question, but plurilateralism may be a way forward. Plurilateralism may not be the first best solution. Again, for those who are not at the negotiation table, many concerns remain. But it seems to be the preferred option for them in comparison to regional trade agreements or mega regionals of which they're not a part. I would like to underline that if plurilateralism is going to be the way forward, it should follow certain criteria. As mentioned earlier, it should be in line with MFN principles, and it should be open to accession. If these principles are being taken into account, it could be a promising way forward, as many commentators, I think, agree. But there remains more debate on how this will shape the future of the global trading system. And I would be curious to hear more about what others would have to say on plurilaterals.
Okay. Thanks, Said. Please.
Starting with this specific question on plurilaterals, yes, this is another way of negotiation. And to make the things forward in negotiations could be one alternative, especially for certain areas. I don't know whether it could be an across the board solution for all issues within the trading system. Anyway, but this is practical. But I agree with Clara that the plurilaterals also need principle or should be based on principles that make them more in line with the multilateral ideas. Otherwise, we will have a lot of different animals and then will make things even much worse, just like the regional agreements. I mean, I'm not completely against all these different improvisations of plurilaterals and regionals, but they should be kept under multilateral system. That is to the benefit of everyone. And I think that is a good chance for G20 to bring, and especially for T20, to bring ideas for G20 at the political level, so that we can find new mechanisms, or we talk about more mechanisms and guiding principles to make these plurilaterals and also regional agreements more in line with the multilateral system. Okay.
Thanks a lot to you both. Any more questions? Yeah, Dr. John first and Alejandro afterwards.
Yeah, I have a simple question going to a same manner from Peterson. In your presentation, you talked about the issues on the government subsidies. You said TPP is not against subsidies, not against the SOEs. It's true. And also you said TPP is only against distorting subsidies. I'm wondering, are there any assessments, you know, helping us to tell the difference between distorting subsidies or non-distorting subsidies?
I think already Alejandro already said what I want to say. All subsidies are distorting. Alejandro, please.
Yeah, subsidies are granted or maintained just because the government seeks to change something in the marketplace. So they're all distorted one way or another, except that some are better than others. Depends on the objective. And I just wanted to make a comment on plurilaterals. Plurilaterals, non-discriminatory plurilaterals, are predicated on the basis that you have a critical mass, meaning that no non-participant in a plurilateral agreement is big enough to spoil the deal. In other words, that there will now be big free riders which make any deal politically impossible. And that translated into, let's say, numbers of the realities of today, I think that in almost any sector, whether it be services or goods, etc., you need the critical mass, and you need the United States, the EU, China, Japan, and in some sectors you need India and Brazil, okay, at least. So if that is the case, if those key players are able to agree in any one thing, I wonder why they would not be able to do a multilateral deal across the board on everything. So then you don't need a plurilateral. The point I'm trying to make is that today's difficulties with the negotiation is not because a consensus among 160-something countries is difficult, but because there's no consensus or basic agreement among 5-6 key players, and that's what has killed the Doha round.
Yeah, thank you, Alejandro. Before the 5 or 6, I think we need the two biggest guys, Shaq O'Neal and Yao Ming, to play basketball together with us. And Sean, I give the floor to you on this question about subsidies distorting and or non-distorting, please.
Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Zhang, for your question. So the TPP, the rules on SOEs in the TPP say that distorting subsidies you can only know after the fact. And so the criteria is that if an SOE is subsidized and it takes a significant amount of market share from a company that is from another TPP country, that is a market distorting subsidy. So if, you know, for example, you know, TV maker gets subsidized and takes a significant amount of market share from another, you know, maybe Samsung or something, then there is, you can have trade sanctions at that point. But subsidies in an area where, you know, for example, in the U.S. for Amtrak or something, there are no other foreign competitors in that sector in the U.S. There are no other domestic, you know, foreign train services in the U.S. So a subsidy in that area does not count.
Okay. Thanks, Sean. With that, I will have to close the questions and answers. I will now give the floor to all the panelists, and I'm starting from Dr. Kim and all the way to the other side. Each one and a half minutes only, please, because we have time issue. Please go ahead, Dr. Kim.
Yes, very, very short one. Actually, we have a very nice example of the subsidy issue. In the late 1990s, the Korea and then the EU, the subsidies on the semiconductor, and then the EU did not approve the specialties of the subsidies. So the finally, the Korea won, and so it means that the subsidies is very, very difficult to approve. Of course, we need to ban the distorting, tremendously distorting subsidies. So we need to abide by the general principle of the WTO subsidy rules. So I think that that is very important for the domestic players to tremendously notice that you need to curb the illegal or the distorting subsidies. Okay, and then. One more thing, very, very briefly. Well, when the presentation about the economic the impact of the U.S. and China FTA, the picture is very, very similar to the Korea at the U.S. FTA. Very, very similar. Every the plus minus something like that. Very, and then what happens after the Korea U.S. FTA? Now the 5 years, so that is quite a big concern to the Chinese friends, because Korea's trade surplus increased by 3 times after entering the force of the Korea U.S. FTA. Already you have a tremendous trade surplus with the United States, so maybe the FTA is, the picture is very similar to the Korea, U.S. FTA. Then it means that maybe China enjoyed more than triple, 3 times increase of the trade surplus. How can you endure this kind of things?
Thanks, Clara, please.
Thank you for all your questions and inputs. While it's true that it's not easy to motivate critical mass to achieve plurilateral agreements that can be successful, it has happened in the recent past. So it will be exciting to see how this development in terms of plurilateral negotiations develops in the future, because that will crucially determine the future of the global trading system or shape it. If I stress 3 takeaway points. Thinking about the T20 process and also the G20 process this year and in the coming month, I think I would like to stress that if we think about coherence, we should think about coherence both between the regional and the multilateral track, but also about coherence with the sustainability agenda of the 2030 agenda. Secondly, we should challenge the G20 to foster transparency in the global trade system, both within the WTO but also outside of it. And last but not least, it would be great if the G20 went on to clarify principles and procedures for plurilateral negotiations and agreements to make sure that they can be a useful building block for the global trading system in the future. But I think there's enough critical mass in this room that wants lunch, so I will stop here now in order to not keep you longer.
Yes, Clara, Uli, please.
Yeah, I will pass. We had a lot of repetitions of I think the good ideas and solutions here. I think there was quite some overlapping, but repetitions are good because it shows that there is consensus. Mm-hmm. So I pass, but only if nobody of my followers is taking my time.
Well, I'll try not to do that, but I'll address quickly Mr. Kim's comments about the bilateral trade deficit with China. China's service sector is rather closed, and the U.S. has a comparative advantage in services. So if China were to open up its service sector, U.S. would have a huge improvement in exports to China, not like with Korea, where its service sector was relatively open. But I also add that, so the goal for this book was free trade between the US and China, not necessarily through a comprehensive FTA. That is the least likely option. The next likely option would be China joining TPP or a free trade area of the Asia Pacific. But the most likely option is actually a step-by-step process where by China and the U.S. agree to a bilateral investment treaty, and then they get some liberalization through three of the plurilaterals, ITA, EGA, and TISA, if the U.S. will ever allow China to join TISA, and then through the GPA, things like this. So,
thank you. Thank you for the questions as well, and all the comments from my colleagues. Well, T20 is sometimes called as the bank of ideas. So we produce ideas, humble ideas, that needs to be improved. And I think this is a good stage and a good venue to improve the ideas on multilaterals and regionals, and especially mega regionals. Because what I can say to my point is that we should put the WTO at the core of the discussion of multilaterals and regionalism. And I think that is one important task for T20. That was not one of the priorities, by the way, in B20, to put the RTAs into the core. I think business is more practical, but we need to have more deeper ideas about these regional issues, and we produce some or brought forward some ideas which we already know, but that has been some kind of consensus, especially concerning the role of spillovers. What will be the impact on third countries, and how could we have a better regulatory cooperation, a system whereby third countries can raise up their standards if they have to have better market access. And the other thing is the transparency mechanism that should also be handled by care and should be improved. And more of all, I think that we should have more connection, as Clara said, between the SDG goals 2030 and the global trade governance. And I'm very happy to hear that it will be one of the priorities also in the German presidency term, at least for your institutions, to bring these issues much into the core. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Anthony, please.
Since no one can take my time, I'll pass so I can benefit for a longer lunch. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I would encourage you to give a big applause to our panelists for their excellent presentations.